Well, Chester, again, he has a sort of insouciance to his whole attitude toward people. He doesn't, he has his own agenda, and anyone in the way is going to have troubles.
Yeah. And the women he meets, he says, it's Calvin Coolidge.
Yeah, he has a series of aliases. And even then, I think it's just a private joke with him. I don't think he actually really cares.
Monty, what was the sort of catalyst for him as a character?
I just actually wanted to have something happen in the book. I think literary novel, I love literary fiction. It interests me the most, artistic fiction, but I believe things have to happen. And of course, I wrote most of this book so long ago, it's hard for me to remember exactly how I constructed it. But I wanted Chester to provide sort of conflict and very mortal conflict for Alvin to try to survive.
Why did you write it so long ago? Or what happened in between?
Well, it's part of a 1,000-page novel that took 12 years to write, my entire 40s. And I don't know how long this side of Jordan's took, because I would, as I write the book, I would alternate chapters.
Yeah.
So write one story, then the other, and I finished the Alvin book maybe in 19, or year 2000 or so. 1999, mm-hmm. I think, because my dad read it before he died.
Yeah.
Well,
we should tell our friends then who your father was.
Yeah, Charles Schulz, right.
Of Peanuts fame.
Yes, exactly.
And the great sort of, he did plot line and storyline in the genre of cartooning.
Right, right. Well, and Dad liked fiction, and he considered it a higher art form. He used to tell me I was raising the level of art in the family, uh-huh. which is very flattering. Not true. But and so he was a great reader, and directed me towards some of my favorite authors: Truman Capote, Carson McCullers, Flannery O'Connor, John Steinbeck, Carl Sandburg, mm-hmm. Edgar Lee Masters, Spoon River Anthology, yeah. and all those writers are present, influentially in this book.
In which way?
Stylistically.
Stylistically.
Yeah, if you read the seance in the book, you'll be able to, if you read Spoon River Anthology and then read the seance, you'll hear the voice from the epitaphs there in Spoon River.
Yeah.
And the lyrical language from Truman Capote is in there as well.
Uh-huh.
Other Voice, Other Rooms.
Yeah. But they go on, and they have almost like what the sort of the peripatetic voyage, the trip.
Right, right. The voyage. It's the journey. It's the journey across the river into the land of death and back, which is, I realized as I was turning the book into Fantagraphics, that's what the novel was really about. This side of Jordan means this side of death, and you see the death, life and death images in the book.
Well, he has, the night he has Alvin and Rascal bury the body.
Yeah, yeah. They have to decide where to bury this kid Chester's killed, because he had a set of keys. And so they're just left at some farm to bury this kid, and they do their duty and leave. But they're sort of, that's the night Alvin decides that Chester is the evilest fellow he ever met.
But he goes on.
Well, he's not smart enough to get away. I've had people ask me, why doesn't he get away? Well, where is he going to go? America was a huge place at that time. There weren't interstate freeways.
Yeah.
He has nowhere to go, and plus it's very clear that Chester knows everybody. And Alvin worries about that in that chapter where they bury the body. He pictured himself being cornered by some sluggers or gunmen and shot down like a dog in an alley. So he knows he can't get away. And he also, Alvin knows he's sort of a dumbbell. He's a dumbbell and he's sick. Again, he's got tuberculosis and he has fever half the time.
Monty, who else were some of your mentors?
I have a professor at UC Santa Barbara who has read all my writing, a professor named Steve Alaback.
Mm-hmm.
And friends reading my stuff here and there. But basically, and another friend of mine up in Vancouver, Washington, named Gardner Mean, who's helped with the other parts of the book, not so much this one.
Have you worked with the writer's group at all?
No, I didn't really believe in that.
Yeah.
It didn't
and
really
yet
help.
You were at the Santa Barbara Writers' Conference.
Yeah, I just liked reading what I'd written and showing off what I could do.
I'm going to ask you to read, though, to let our friends in the audience hear how you write.
Okay. At summer's end, the farm boy from Illinois stood with a leather trunk and a pile of suitcases under the white arc lights of a small rail station platform in southern Nebraska. It was nearly 10:30 and the train was late. A warm evening wind blew through a grove of weeping willows next to the depot, and a crowd of young sports from the state college collected about a pair of Ford automobiles, drinking booze from a thermos bottle and joking. Down at the end of the platform beside the ticket office, Chester Burke sat on a wooden bench with a young brunette the farm boy fancied for himself. She was awfully pretty, with silver blue eyes and a melodic laugh that stirred Alvin's heart. She wore thin white muslin and a pink scarf she fiddled with while Chester flirted. Alvin had noticed her first while he and the dwarf were unloading their baggage from the taxicab. When she was alone, waiting by the depot with a brown valise and a hat box, lace hanky in hand, and weeping unaccountably, Alvin thought to go up and comfort her, perhaps put his arm around her and listen to her troubles, but he was too shy, so he left her alone. Now all Alvin could do was watch helplessly from across the platform while Chester honeyed her up and made the farm boy feel like a lemon.
All through their relationship, Chester can do that to Alvin. He can get furious at Chester. You're a killer, you're this. He doesn't leave. What's the magic?
He is afraid to go anywhere. He realizes pretty early on that Chester's a killer, and Alvin is a long way from home. He's a dumbbell, and he knows it. He's a hick from a farm. He's never been away. He's never been across the Mississippi before this far. He has no idea where to go. And again, he knows he's sick. So he's not, if we think about having a fever, he's got a fever sometimes, 101, 102, you don't think clearly. He's not smart enough. And he senses that Chester knows people everywhere. So it seems hopeless. He just imagines if he tries to get away, one of Chester's friends, associates, a gunman will shoot him in the head in some alley somewhere.
How did he get to understand that Chester had all of these associates?
I think he just sort of, he picks it up as they're going along. Chester seems to know everybody. Wherever they go, Chester's lining up some scheme. And he's leaving Alvin by himself. So Alvin and Rascal are talking all the time about their own lives.
Yeah.
But Chester has this agenda and doesn't share it with them. Wherever they go, Chester tells him what to do and Alvin takes his orders because he doesn't have any choice.
Yeah. Have you known people like that?
No, I hope not.
Well, I don't mean the killer, but that power relationship.
Yeah, I think some people, in some ways, I guess we can divide people into two groups in life, those who give orders and those who take them.
Yeah.
And some people are comfortable taking orders and not giving orders. Some people only want to be in charge.
That's Hitler's good German.
Yeah. Although, again, there were Germans who didn't want to take the orders and tried to flee or do what they could. But some people just do because there aren't any other good options.
Yeah. A strange period in America because it was right after, or not that, but the middle after World War I. And the trying to have a normalcy in America before the beginning of what turns out to be World War II.
Yeah, and before the Great Depression. People forget, a lot of people seem to feel that the 20th century started with the Depression, but there was the Jazz Age. That was a big party. It was a party for 10 years. So people forget about the booze and the speakeasies and the money, millions and millions of dollars people earned in that time period leading up until the crash. So, and it came pretty suddenly. And the Depression really didn't kick in until maybe a couple of years after the crash of 29.
Yeah. Have you spent time with circuses?
I've been to the circus many times when I was a kid and read about them, and I did the research for the book on a few books I bought on circuses from the period, and then reading novels about circuses. Ray Bradbury's Something Wicked This Way Comes, and the circus scene in Truman Capote's Other Voices, Other Rooms.